I want everybody to get out of this place embracing a unique relationship with Jesus. That you go out and you are in this path with the Lord every day. Hallelujah. That you actually embrace it and realize that this is uniquely your own journey. It's unlike your neighbor's journey, but this is uniquely your journey with Christ. We will learn a few things as well from the various scriptures concerning the disciples of Jesus, their experiences, and then we will take it from there. And I'm sure that we're going to be thoroughly blessed. Are you ready? Are you going to respond as we teach the word of God? So Jesus had these 12 boys, these very young teenage boys that he lived with for 3.5 days. Literally, his schedule planner. Say schedule planner. Jesus would plan their schedule. They'll wake up in the morning and they were like, what are we up to today? And then Jesus would say, okay, this is what we're going to do. We'll go to this place. We'll do this and that. And then he will explain to them miracles or things that they did not understand separately. So literally, Jesus would plan their schedules. Did you hear what I said? Jesus would plan their schedules. Who is your schedule planner? Who is your schedule planner? So we see that from that time on, from the 12 boys that Jesus impacted for 3.5 years, you know, fast forwarding to where we are now, 2 billion Christians are followers of Jesus from that little small group that was impacted by Jesus. And you and me are part of that group. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Following Jesus is not just a cute concept. It is a day-by-day walk with Christ. Daily. Daily, one footstep at a time. So following somebody involves a pathway. Can you show me some pictures, Elisha? Did you save them, Pastor? Just flight a few pictures here. I want you to have a look and remember these pictures as we continue with our message. What do you see over there? Oh, let's talk. What do you see? A pathway, right? Is it straight? It's meandering, isn't it? But there is a destination. I suppose maybe beyond the hills far away, there could be a castle. There could be a river. There could be anything. But then it is a pathway that is sort of leading to a destination somewhere. I want you to note that is not straight, right? But then along the sides, you find that it's very green. There's a lot of... you know, there's a lot of life around it. There's hills, there's a hilly place and a little bit of low place, and it's a bit sloppy, a hilly, whatever you call it, but there is a pathway. Go to the next picture. What do you see on this one here? Amen? What do you see? That's another pathway, isn't it? What's the difference with this one? There's just a little bit of green, right? But there's a lot of potential because around there, you know, somebody can come plant seeds and it germinates into something beautiful. This one is sort of straightish, but the circumstances around it don't have as much life as the other one that we saw earlier on. Show us the next one. Are you following? Good. And how about that one? That's another pathway. This one is wider. There's a lot of room, a lot of greenery. This can accommodate a lot of people, right? The other one's probably one or two people, but here quite a number of people can just walk along and probably there's a destination ahead. I want to say to you this morning, following Jesus is a day-by-day process. It's the most exhilarating journey that you can ever embark on. It's got, you know, it's got a lot of satisfaction. It's got a lot of aha moments. Yet at the same time, you may feel like you're swimming up, you know, you're swimming uphill or you're swimming against the current sometimes. You know, it's very fulfilling, but can be challenging. So my aim today is that we be able to talk through this part that we've seen so far. Praise the name of Jesus. Can I have the first scripture there? The confidence that we have, I think it's Isaiah. Yeah. Isaiah 30, verse 21. The Bible says, "And you will hear a voice saying, 'This is the way. Turn around and walk there.'" So following Jesus means that you will hear him speak to you. He will say to you, "This is the way. Follow or turn this other way." Amen. So you're not alone. That's the emphasis I want to make this morning, that we are not alone in our walk. We always have Christ. We've got the Spirit of God that lives within us, that will tell us, "This is the way. Turn around and walk here." Amen. The very same way we saw on the pathways, that sometimes it meanders. The Holy Spirit will tell you, it's time to meander. It's time to go straight. It's time to go over the valley. It's time to go under the bridge and things like that. Let's go to John chapter 21. By the end of this message, when you go home, you will never forget John chapter 21. I'll start reading. Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. So now this is the narration of how Jesus appeared to the disciples. Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and there were two sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were there. So how many people were there? There were six. "I am going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." Then they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Say to your neighbor, they caught nothing. I want you to understand before we get to the gist of the matter is what had happened prior to John chapter 21. Jesus had been crucified. Jesus had been buried and he resurrected. But then the disciples hadn't spent so much time, even though he appeared twice before to them, they hadn't spent the time that they were used to, like day and night with him. So everything was just a blur. You know, they were disappointed that actually the Savior did die, you know. There was a bit of letdown, I think, to some of them that, so he's actually gone. Is life ever going to be the same? This is the guy that was scheduling, he was our schedule planner. This was a guy who was, you know, working with us, explaining things to us. Is life going to be the same without him? Jesus knew all those things. That's why he would appear there, appear a week later to these ones, just to say, "Hey guys, what I said, that I will rise again, is true. I'm actually here." So in John chapter 21, we see the disciples are just, you know, relaxing. And Peter decides, "You know what? I want to go fishing." Do you know, I used to read this before I researched. What I'm going to tell you is going to blow your mind. I just used to read it plainly and thought, oh, Peter just wanted to go fishing, right? Like as a recreation sort of thing. Like, oh, I'm bored. I want to go out and have a swim, right? But it's different. The Hebrew word for going fishing there, where is it? It's translated hubako, hupako, H-U-P-A-G-O, meaning go away or go back to. So Peter, with all these things happening, he reckons, you know what? I'm going to go back to fishing. Peter was a fisherman before he was called by Jesus. That was his trade. That was what he did for life. Jesus calls him off with his brother and says, you know, come, I'll make you fishers of men. The Bible says immediately they left their things and they followed him and they became fishers of men. He had never gone back to fishing. Do you understand? He had never gone back to fishing fish from the river or from the sea, because they were occupied. Jesus was there doing life with them, teaching them how to follow him. So they were occupied, they were safe. But then this person is being taken away from them. He's died. He thinks to himself, you know what? The only thing that I know, the only thing that I've experienced in is fishing. I am going to go back and start fishing. Because there was a situation, the Savior had been taken away from them. I want to ask you a question, child of God, this morning and say, when things happen in your life, what is your response? Do you leave this place that you have been put in, a place called being in Christ, and go back to familiar ways? Go back to self-effort. Go back to things that you were doing before you got born again, because it's easier. Oh, this striving to rest thing, you know, I have to constantly put myself in a position of rest. How many of us know that worrying is actually easier than resting? It's easy to worry about everything. But then the Bible says, worry not, and you have to sit down and say, okay, you mind, I put you under subjection. It takes effort. Some of us, before we became Christians, our money was our own. At any time, I could do anything that I want. But as a child of God, I'm realizing, wow, this money is actually God's. I'm a steward of this money. I'm going to take something and give it to the Lord. That's a bit hard, isn't it? It's easy for me to what? Keep my money. Is it making sense to somebody? I used to be a master of my own life. I could go wherever I want to go. But now I sort of have to find out, Holy Spirit, should I go? Should I do this? Should I talk to that person right now? But before that, it was just everything goes. It was like, kusera, sera. It shall, whatever will be, will be. So then when trouble happens, when shakings come, it's very easy to want to go back fishing. Guess what happened when Peter said, I'm going to go back to fishing? The other six says, we'll go with you. We'll also live the life that we'd known with Christ. We'll follow you. How many of us have had pastors that have fallen and like the whole church is like, this God thing, you know, I forget it. Because Peter was not an ordinary guy. This is the dude that walked on water, remember? This is the dude that was there on Transfiguration, remember? This is the dude who was there at the Garden of Gethsemane, remember? He was in the inner circle of Jesus. He was not ordinary. He was not just one of those, but he was a servant. He was a disciple, one of the three that was close to Jesus. But then time came before the death of Jesus where Christ said, Peter, you would deny me before the cock crows three times. Peter said, Lord, no, you know I love you so much. I can never do that to you. But then time came, Jesus was taken away, the cock crowed three times. And guess what? Peter remembered after refusing and saying, I don't know Jesus, three times, that, oh, I have let God down. I have let my friend down. I've let my big brother down. The Bible says he went away and he wept bitterly. So this is the same guy that we are now finding in John 21. After all the exploits that I've just told you, he said, you know what? I'm just going to go fishing. I'm just going to go fishing. Not just going fishing, but I'm going back to being a fisherman. Nudge your neighbor and say, can you hear this? Pastor's talking to you. Anyway, these guys go anyway, they get into the boat, they go fishing. Did you see what happened? They caught nothing. You see, the devil will come and tell you that your life was better off before. You are better if you had all the money to yourself. You are better if you, back then when you're in total control of your life. But guess what? That's a lie from the pit of hell. Because that was self-effort and you benefited nothing. These guys toiled. The Bible says they toiled the entire night and they caught nothing. Could they have just gone back and slept? Wasn't it better for them to go back home and just sleep the whole night? They're going to wake up refreshed. But because they wanted to revert to their old ways, the very place where Christ had taken them away from and said, you know, come, stop being a fisherman. Come fish for men. And they want to go back there where they were fishers, fishermen. And this time around, things have changed. Things have changed. You want to go and fish? There is no fish. Even the fish run away because they know they are not supposed to be there. You are not supposed to be there. You are in the wrong place. The fish looked and said, we don't know that bait. We're not going to eat it. There were seven fishermen in that boat. Seven. All of them caught nothing the whole night. The Bible is very clear. It says they toiled. Later on in the scriptures, you realize that when Jesus came and when Peter realized that it was Christ, he put his garment. So literally, Peter, they worked so hard that Peter had stripped off his clothes. That was how much self-effort they had put. They'd removed even clothes like, here we are working, guys. But we never hear any time when they're working with the master that they removed their clothes and they did everything all night and caught nothing. There was always instant result when they're walking with Jesus, when they were doing things with the Lord. Jesus, in his greatness and in his mercy, he comes into the scene. He says, children, let's go back to our scriptures there. Verse 4, early in the morning, Jesus is amazing. He will let you have it your way for a very long time. He could have appeared in the middle of the night or in the first hour where they didn't catch anything. But Jesus waited until morning just to show to them that you guys, you can't do this alone. You need me. He comes. And he says, he stood on the shore, the Bible says. But the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus because they're not expecting him. How many times in our lives has Christ appeared? You know, the hand of God or the help from above appears and you can't even recognize it because you are so stuck in what you're doing. You are so stuck in your toiling that you even don't realize the help that God has sent for you. God says, angels, help us. Go help them. Go help him. But no, I can't even realize. You know, like Jacob who says, the Lord was in this place. And I didn't know it. I did not realize. May God open up our eyes to realize when he comes to help us. When he sends people to help us. Amen. So you go back to verse 4. They didn't realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? Sounds like a mockery. He knew that they didn't have fish, right? He says, friends, did you catch anything? Remember, he was on the show, right? This was like a shouting match. He was on the show and these guys were Just picture it, you know, picture this. He's on the beach, right? He's looking at this boy like, hey, friends, did you catch any fish? He's like, no, we did not catch any. And I'm sure some of them that were gifted with the words began to explain further. We've been here the whole night. Probably so blaming each other started, I told you we're supposed to go that way. No, you know, look, people are even asking us. Because they did not realize that it was Jesus. And then he says, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. Question is, did they not throw the net on the right side before? These were seasoned fishermen. Probably they tried this side and there was no fish. They tried the other side, and there was no catch. They tried forward, and there was no catch. They tried every side. But now Jesus comes and says, okay, things are going to change right now because I've declared a word. Throw on the right side of the net. And guess what? They did exactly that. And they caught, is it 153 big, nice, scrumptious looking fish. There's another story in the Bible of people that have, Simon, I guess that's his name. Jesus had the same instruction for him. Launch out into the deep and you get some fish. And there was so much fish that they actually called other people to come help them carry. What am I saying to us, Caris Church, this morning? At his word, at his instruction, at his instruction, that's when you get results. You can do it the way you want, but you're going to toil the whole night. And when you get to the end of yourself, when you get to the end of yourself, that's when the grace of God then comes in and says, okay, no more of your self-effort. Embrace me. Which one's easier? Embracing favor or doing it the long way? Let's keep going. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garments around him, for he had taken them off. I think he was in his undies, you know, and he jumped into the water. He jumped into the water. Now the guy is swimming frantically, trying to get to Jesus. When they landed, they saw a fire. Jesus had prepared breakfast. The love of Jesus. He knew that these guys had been working the whole night. He prepared food for them. Supernaturally provided fish. Because it wasn't even the fish that they brought him, because there was fish already that had been cooked. Where did Jesus get that fish from? Anyway, they came, they eat, and all is well. Now, the gist of my sermon in the next 10 minutes. Let's go to verse 15. When he had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Like he's talking to Simon, right? Do you love me more than these ones? When I read that, I was like, Jesus, really? Like, comparing Simon, wanting him to say, yes, I love you more than this. Isn't that interesting? Anyway, he said, yes, Lord, I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things. Surely you know my heart. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But then you are old. You will stretch out your hand and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this, indicating the kind of death by which Peter could glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Is someone getting this? Jesus asked him, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? The guy is hurt, like, Lord, you know I love you. And then what does he do later? He describes the kind of death that he was going to go through. And still, with that kind of death, he says, follow me. Is it making sense? Right, verse 20. Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was John, right? Peter says, Lord, verse 21. When Peter saw him, he asked, Lord, what about him? Now, that is where everything changes. I've got two lessons for you before you go home from that passage about walking every day with Jesus. Peter asks Jesus and says, what about this guy who's following? Jesus says, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me. Because of this, the rumor spread among the believers that the disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? This is the disciple who testifies these things and who wrote them down. The first lesson, church, is everybody alert? I want you to really get this. When we follow Jesus, we follow the same person, but not the same path. When we follow Jesus, we're following the same person, but we're not in the same path. We follow the same scriptures, we follow the same truth, but the reality is our paths are different. You see, it gets very difficult when you decide to look at somebody's path and compare it to yours. Jesus was talking to Peter alone and saying, Peter, this is your path. You follow me. This is what is going to happen to you. You love me and you will die this way, but I still want you to follow me. And then he looks around and says, okay, you want me to follow you, but how about this guy? How about this guy? Jesus says, look, if I want him to live until I come, what is that to you? Like, what business is that to you in terms of you following me? So in other words, don't worry about your neighbor. You have your own race to follow. You have your own path to follow that has been created by God, that has been designed specifically for you. In other words, Jesus was saying, well, what if John lives happily ever after and not die? But you, follow me. You see, our problem as Christians is that we have compared. We have compared our paths. Have you ever met a person whose path looks wider, like the other one that I showed you? It looks greener, you know? You know, it looks cool. It looks cooler than yours. And you look at your path, you're like, you actually need a torch sometimes to look through your path. And you're like, Lord, what's wrong? There is nothing wrong. That is your path. That is your path. And the grace of God is sufficient for you during that times when your path looks narrow, when your path looks dry, when your path is meandering. The grace of God is enough for you. The Bible says, you know, in Proverbs, it says that the path of the righteous, it gets brighter and brighter. So even if it can look narrow in this area right now, it gets brighter and brighter. Don't look at your friend. Don't look at your friend. You know, her husband's got a six-pack. You know, she's got 4 kids. She lives in a duplex. They drive 6 cars. You know, he's a CEO. You know, for us pastors, you know, their church has just grown in the last 2 months by 500. Oh, I've just been promoted. And you look at yourself, Lord, why? How about me? How about me, Lord? I'm renting. My husband has got a half peg. You know? Everything around my life, not my husband doesn't have a half peg. Everything. Will I ever buy a house? We've met some people. They'll be like, yeah, Pastor, yeah, I just bought my second house. So we're actually working out things or buying the third one in like 2 months. We're like, amen. That's great. But the Bible says the path of the righteous is like a morning sun. It shines ever bright until the full light of day. Keep following Jesus. Don't lose track. Don't lose track. It's not about the path. It's about the person that you're following. The problem is we tend to look down on our path and say, oh my God, look at that pothole right here. What am I going to do? Wow, it's filling up with water. And you're standing right there next to your pothole. But Jesus says, follow me. So what am I supposed to do if there's a pothole? I'm like, okay, probably jump over it. Let's keep going. Who's the leader? Who's the boss? Who's the boss? Who's the boss? Who's the boss? Keep following the boss. Embrace your unique path. It's tailor-made for you. Amen. Amen. The most difficult thing that I want to teach us as your pastor this morning, celebrate other people's paths. Hallelujah. I said celebrate other people's paths. You're getting married. Congratulations. You bought a house. Wow, God is good. Your church has reached 1,000. That's awesome. You are graduating, and you know you haven't graduated. You're struggling to graduate. Yay! Amen. You've got a boyfriend. Yay! Celebrate their parts. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I say celebrate their parts. Come on, give your neighbor a high five and say, I celebrate your path. I celebrate what God is doing in your life. Don't compare yourself. People come and say, what do you think about this other church? I think they're doing great. They're in their path, following God. What do you think about that preacher? I think they're great. They're in their path and they're following God. They're following Jesus. What do you think about so and so? That behavior is not Christian. No. They are in their path. They are following Jesus. Celebrate other people's success. It's so hard, especially when your path is looking bleak at that time. Instead of celebrate, I remember when I was doing driving tests. I went a few times. I failed. And we used to live with my sister-in-law. You know, she also was doing driving lessons. Our first car was a victim of crashes because two people were learning to drive. And, you know, this one will, you know, hit it on the garage door. And the other one, next time, you know, it was a casualty case, that car. I feel so sorry for it. I went twice. You know, I failed. She went first time around. I remember that day. I'm going to be honest. I'm going to be honest. I was sitting in the lounge, checking the time, waiting for her to come back. I wanted to hear if she got her license. My heart was pounding, not with joy. She came. She sat down. I'm like, how did it go? Like, oh, I failed. My heart rejoiced. I gave her a hug. I was like, you know what? It's okay. You know. So in my heart, I was like, yes, I'm not the only one. You know, it was not so much about them, but I was afraid that, you know, she was going to get her license before me. And that would hurt my feelings so much because I had gone before her. This is anyway. I booked 2 more weeks. I'm like, oh, that's okay. Then she went on the second one. Same thing happened. The enemy was really using that, you know. She came. I was like, she got that guy who's notorious for failing people. She came, she's like, guess what? I passed. You know, I had the tears of joy, not tears of joy. I was crying, but not why me? Why not me? You know, I was happy for her, but her blessing became my sorrow because I was looking at myself and comparing my path with hers. Like, Lord, how come she got hers right now and I haven't got my license? How many times have I gone? You know, I'm a mother. She's not a mother. I've got kids. You know, my husband is here. You think, what will he think? You know, all those things. But guess what? That was her path. God knew that at that time she was going to give the glory to him. Celebrate other people's paths. The next point, don't limit your path and think it's the only path that you walk for the rest of your life. Did you hear that, church? Don't think, oh, this is where I am right now. I don't see any change, you know, imminent. God is famous for creating new pathways. The Bible says that he makes, you know, he makes pathways in the desert. He creates pathways where there is no sign that there would ever be a path. Because he's generous, because he's loving, because he's kind. If you look at your life and think and put judgment on yourself and say, I'm gonna be a spinster for the rest of my life. I'm gonna be broke for the rest of my life. No. That's not the path that you'll be in forever. Remember the path that I showed you. It was meandering. Sometimes green, sometimes dry. But you know what? Jesus is still there. He's leading you and you get to your destination. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is famous for creating new pathways and your life does turn. I'll tell you a little story about myself. Other people, maybe they don't know, but those that have known me for a while, they know. I mean, I was a pretty intelligent student at school and I wanted to marry a guy who was smart. Like I told myself, please don't judge me. I told myself I'm not going to marry a teacher. I'm not going to marry a teacher. I'm not going to marry a nurse. I'm not going to marry a soldier. I'm not going to, you know, I like all these. No. I'm not going to marry that kind of. I want a guy with a degree, you know, a guy with a master's, you know, a guy with. This. And God is humorous, isn't he? He's like, okay, I'll give you one. Got myself a guy with a degree in metallurgical engineering. I did not even know what metallurgical engineering was. But so I got married, right? Need I? And I'm going to tell you, I said, I am never going to marry a pastor in my life. No pastor for me. Anybody who was looking like they're the calling of God, I literally turn my back on them. Because I didn't want to be poor. That was the only reason. Pastors were poor. Pastors were used by people. You know? I was like, nah, not me. God gave me the package as I wanted it. And I celebrated God. He's faithful. Was it three years? We went full time. He stopped the metallurgical engineering. The six-figure metallurgical engineering stopped. My path kept changing and changing, but I kept following God, kept following Jesus. Jesus knew or still knows me better than I know myself. I did not know at that time that I would love pastoring the way I love it now. I did not know that. There are so many things that you don't know about yourself that will be revealed in the years to come. You'll be like, wow, I did not know that, you know, I love people. I didn't know that I love to cook. I didn't know I love this race. I didn't know, you know, so many things. But your path keeps changing. God keeps directing you. Now it's time to jump. It's time to swim. It's time to run. It's time to walk. All in your path that is ordered by God. What we do is that we can make all these amazing plans, right? But we don't know how to get to that destination of the plan. But then God then begins to order one step at a time. That's your path. You're walking to the very plans that you have planned, right? Provided God is in there and God is in agreement. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is this making sense to somebody? Probably this is the last point. Be careful to make presumptions about other people's pathways. It's very easy. This is happening. Surely that can't be God. Surely they're doing something wrong in that church. Surely that's not how you treat a wife. You don't know. You don't know. No presumptions. We normally presume because our paths are radically different. Because it's different for you, from yours, doesn't mean it's the wrong path. Amen. Amen. I said, because it's different from yours, doesn't mean it's wrong. The last point, we are following a person with a very strong will. You know, I love strong-willed people. I think I'm sort of, am I strong-willed? I think I am a little bit. Strong-willed people are usually very smart. They're determined. You know, they know what they want in life. The downside of it is that they always want to have their way. Right? I've got good news to you about Jesus. He's a very strong will. His will concerning my life is very strong. His will concerning my life is perfect. He has never desired evil for me. His plans are for good. His plans are to prosper me and give me an expected end. He's a good shepherd. He says, I shall not want. I shall not be in lack. He leads me and I follow. Hallelujah. He is jealous over me. He says, goodness and mercy shall follow me for the rest of my life. His plans concerning me are of good. Hallelujah. So he has got a very strong will concerning my life. That's why he puts me in the path that I am so that I can follow him. Amen. I can decide to cry when I hit bumpy waters, but you know what? I know that goodness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. The Bible says he perfects everything that concerns me. Everything that concerns you, you know that God is perfecting it. Hallelujah. 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 Say, I am a success. Come on, say it with me. Say, I am a success. I am a success. Declare it over your family and say, we are a success. Declare over this church and say, we are a success. We are not we're successful. We are a success ourselves. You as you are a success. Why? Because God's will concerning your life is very strong. You are valued. You are valued. He's orchestrating everything to work together for good for you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallah. So why should you be troubled? Why should you be dismayed? Maggie, it's a little bump along the way. It's a little bump along your path, but you're following Jesus. The Bible says, with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, he delivers us. Amen. Hallelujah. Say, my life is secure. My life is secure. Helpers have been dispatched to help me in my path. Come on, do you believe what I'm saying? Come on, say it like you mean it. Helpers have been dispatched to help me in our path. Hallelujah. So steps speak of a day by day walking with Jesus. Daily. You're following Jesus every day. Every day. What are we doing today, Lord? Not, okay, Lord, this is what I want you to do. This is what I want you today, to do today. So you can come in my boat, and I think me and you can make a great party, right? People that are intelligent, usually, that have got everything together, they'll be like, I've got my degree, I've got my job. I think the next thing that's lacking is spirituality. So Jesus, if you come in, you know, me and you can really work well. You know, this is gonna be good when I'm a Christian. But that's a wrong way of doing things. The moment he comes in, it's now his will concerning your life. It's no longer, this is what I want to do about my life, God. What do you think? It's like, Lord, what do you want concerning my life? Do you remember the story of the prodigal son? When he left, you know, he said to his father, give me all that is mine. I want it. Give me, right? The father says, okay. Gives him all his inheritance, goes away. He squanders it. But then he came to a turning point in his life where he realized that, you know what? I need my father. His attitude was different. When he comes back, he doesn't say, Father, give me accommodation again. He says, make me. Do you see the difference? Before it was full of confidence, full of myself. You give me. But this time around is, you make me. That's a sign of maturity. In our everyday walk with God, Lord, make me a better servant for your church. Make me a better wife. And because we've got the great Holy Ghost living inside of us, he helps us in all things. And the grace of God is sufficient for us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Why follow Jesus? Because there's treasure in Jesus. Hallelujah. There is treasure in Jesus. So, the focus is on who? The focus is on who? The focus is on who? Come on, Caris. The focus is on who? On Jesus. The beauty is on who? And who is the leader? Jesus is my boss. Jesus is my boss. One of my friends, she says, you know, the Holy Spirit is the extraordinary strategist for me. If somebody is boasting about how the Holy Spirit strategizes things for them, I think that's to be desired.